हेलो हेलो
सो आई थिंक एवरी वन हैज ऑलरेडी सेटल डाउन एंड एंड क्वाइट अवेयर लाइक वट आई एम गोइंग टू स्पीक ऑन. डू हैव गाइज एनी आइडिया लाइक वट आई एम गोइंग टू स्पीक ऑन? यू ऑलमोस्ट हैव रेड द एटलीस्ट द टाइटल ऑफ द टॉक, राइट? ओके, सो टुडे आई विल बी स्पीकिंग अबाउट पावरिंग सूसी ए आई वेब क्लाइंट्स विथ रिएक्ट एंड रिडक्स. सो there are a few keywords out here which may be familiar to people, maybe web clients, React, Redux. So we'll maybe dive deep into it in the talk. So let me speak about myself. I am Akshat, and I'm an active open source contributor for Force Asia. And I was a student developer for Force Asia during the GSOC, that is a Google Summer of Code 2018. And apart from that, I also mentor for Force Asia in the Google Coding Contest, which are for the junior age group around 13 to 18 years. And also for the Code Heat, which is a like competition organized by Force Asia itself. And like professionally, I work as a web engineer at Uber. So you all can reach me out at these links if you want. So yes, so the project which I'm going to talk about, it is SUSI.AI. And it was the project under the Google Summer of Code, which I had worked like during the Google Summer of Code for Force Asia. So the first question that comes to the mind is, what is SUSI.AI? So any clue, anyone? Like, what is SUSI.AI? Everyone is talking about SUSI.AI everywhere. There are stickers. And so yeah, SUSI.AI is an intelligent open source personal assistant. So if I try to explain you in a more familiar and naive terms, it may be similar as the Amazon Alexa or the Google Home. So SUSI.AI is an intelligent open source personal assistant which is capable of chat and voice interactions. So basically, we have the chat platform for SUSI.AI where you can ask your queries and similar to the other platforms, and you can, and it's capable of the both the chat platform, which is the text platform, and the voice input as well. And it can perform various actions. It may be like searching on the web. You can search for images, then you can check out the weather if you want. And so these basically have a architecture which it works on. And you can query things which are actually fed into the system. So moving ahead, so why did we, like, what was the need of maybe building SUSI.AI? So if we go into the goals, like why, what are the final goals which we're aiming for? So firstly, we need a free assistant. As I already spoke about, so we already have Amazon Alexa, Google Home. Those are all proprietary softwares. And we do not have open source alternative for these. So here comes SUSI.AI. We are offering an open source free assistant. And people are, nowadays, like, it's very boring to type and then express everything, right? So conversational web is the future. Like, we just want to, like, maybe talk to some device or something and then let our, like, get our work done. So that is the point. And it is also very expensive to develop own solutions. Like, Google is a very big company, and maybe Amazon is a very big firm. So they have the money and the manpower to actually do that. But what if you want to like set this up for your own organization, maybe a startup or an even smaller size organization? So that is one point. And it is highly like customizable. Since it's open source and we have given the flexibility to actually, we have given the flexibility to customize each and every point, as because since it was made with the intention like it will be open source. So we have kept in mind that each and every organization can actually use that and then take advantage of that. So like we'll be speaking about the SUSI.AI architecture. So yeah, this is it. And we have the SUSI.AI server in between, as you can see in the center of the slide. And it is actually our backend server which exposes the various API endpoints. And it follows the REST architecture. So in the center, we have the SUSI.AI server. And server basically has various skills, and it is, and skills is also in a form of Git repository, so you can directly actually contribute to the skills part as well. And the skills and the skills CMS, so we have a web client called the skills CMS, which is actually the maybe the marketplace, as you call, or the directory for all the skills that are actually offered by SUSI as of now. And we have various, and behind the hood in the server, we have the console services and various system components like authentication and the CMS, which actually makes the server up and running. And if we come to the like clients part with which actually the user interacts. We have various clients like the web chat. We have the Linux app. We have the Android app, iOS app, then various extensions and messenger bots as well. So if I try to like explain what is the actual workflow behind it, so if suppose I'm a user, I'll go to any of these clients which is actually available. It may be the SUSI web chat. It is like hosted in chat.susi.ai. Or it may be any form of the other bots which is actually integrated already. So you go ahead and then type any query. So sort something like, what is the weather today? So what happens is the API call from that goes to the server, and the server processes it based on the skill Git repository that we have. So we have a SUSI mind, which actually processes and gives us the right information based on what skill it matches to. So yeah, so SUSI AI server, then it actually processes it and returns a JSON to the clients. So now the clients can actually display whatever you had queried for, and then this is how it works. Yeah, so I talked a lot about skills, SUSI skills. So what are actually skills? No, they are not interchangeable. Like, they are not compatible cross-platform. It's not compatible yet. Yeah. So as I talk about skills, so skills are the fundamental logic or the working you can tell behind the SUSI. So if I tell in the SUSI CMS, we have multiple skills. Like, it may be a weather skill. It may be a horoscope skill. It may be some like. Somebody likes to watch movies, so you can get a movie recommendation skill. So skills are the tiniest feature that SUSI actually has. And the collection of many skills actually is fed into the SUSI servers, which actually returns the query that we want. So this is, I didn't get you. Yeah, you can do it because yes, you can do that on your, like.
We define our own skills.
Yes, you can do that. Yeah. I'll take up questions after the session, then we can have a proper discussion. So, yeah, the scheme to organize skills. So we actually need a proper structure how we'll organize skills, right? Then only we can actually frame it. So we have a naming such as model, group, language, and then skill. So the model can be of type public or private. Maybe you want to create a skill which is you don't want to expose it to all the public, and like you only want to keep it to yourself. So you can actually define those modes in the model. And then the group, we have various kind of categories. So a skill can be a communication skill. It can be a new skill. It can be a place, like sports skill, anything. So group actually divides, bifurcates in these criterias. Then we have language. So as it is open source, so it will be used around the world. And we have multiple kind of languages actually spoken around the world. So we actually have, after the criteria, we also have different languages skills. So we have skills for English, Hindi, like all the languages around the world. And after that, we have the final skill, which is basically a text file, which looks like this. So it is very like user intuitive and very easy to understand, lot of format. So suppose if you go log into SUSI skill CMS, and then you want to create a skill. So the format will be, you'll write your name, that just the credit part, name, author, URL, description, dynamic content, and then this is how the user interaction part looks like. So you can actually write user query, and this is just a sample query, but we have different patterns and various logic that you can actually fit into the skill. So just a basic example, if I speak, if you write here, hi, just hi. And then in the next line, if you write, hi, I am SUSI. This is the simplest skill that you can create. And when you like deploy it, you can save it. And then what happens is, when you actually write hi on your SUSI client, the API request will go back to the server. And then the server will process it, and then find that this query was actually made into your skill. And then it will return the query as per what was written in your skill, and then all the other metadata. This is how it works. So like talking about the SUSI web clients, so we have the chat client. I would like to show that. This is how. This is the most basic skill that SUSI offers. You say a hi, and then it says a hello. And it also, as you can see a upvote and downvote option in the response. So this is how we are planning to actually retrain our system so that it can also sometimes give not that correct answer, which is not 100% correct. So we are planning to use this data, which is stored in the form of logs, and then actually give correct output to the users, which is sort of a feedback mechanism. Yeah. So now talking about. Skill CMS, as I already talked, skill CMS is the directory for all the skill that SUSI has. So as I discussed, like we have various groups or categories that we can actually define skill into. Like we have business and finance, communication, games, knowledge, and many others. So if I like go to a particular skill, it may be a sort of anagram skill. So anagrams, and you can see the author's name and the rating, description about the skill, skill details. This is the rating, like 5-star rating system that we implemented during this GSOC itself. The ratings over time, feedback, and stuff, yeah. And we have the accounts. SUSI web app also, which actually is concerned about the authentication in your login, and you can actually change your settings and stuff. This is for the accounts part. So yeah, coming to the main topic of the talk, so the current implementation after the integration, for the front end we have used ReactJS, which is a front end library like developed by open source by Facebook. And the main prime reason for using React was the ability to give like separate UI into several components. First was that, and the very fast and reliable UI DOM tree that it creates via diffing algorithm, and it creates a virtual DOM and stuff. And so basically what happens is you can actually create UI components and then divide into, and it increases the reusability of your code, and also the it gives a very high performance as per stats. And main like Redux we have used. So Redux is kind of a state management library, which we actually use for manipulating the data that comes from the server to the clients. So suppose if I speak about Redux, suppose you have already, you go on the login dialog box and then you log in. And the response for the login like API comes that you are this user, and it identifies you as this user. Then the response which comes, it is actually stored in the store on the client itself. And then you can, so basically it prevents any, so it actually manages all the data which is stored on the client like in running time. Material UI is for the theming and the like UI looks of the part. And Axios we have used for making network calls like over HTTP. So why are we here, like, any clue? So we are here to learn about the integration of Redux and how we did went about it. So the question is, why do we use Redux? Why not, like previously we had the Flux architecture. Why did we go for Redux and not Flux? So the main reason is, there are five simple and very straightforward reasons, and it has been answered by Dan Abramov. So the first part is reducer composition. So in case of Redux, we have a single source of truth, that is a single store, which actually contains all the data. And there is no, we don't have any dispatches between several individual stores, which we actually need in case of Flux. So reducer, it brings down all the complexities of managing multiple stores at a time. And it maintains a single source of truth. And the data flows from top to down. I suppose, like, if you have a root component, the data will actually be fed into the root component and it will flow down to the basic level of UI. It may be as simple as a checkbox, as you can say. Server rendering, so Flux also has the capability of like server rendering. But the issue with Flux is, again, it comes back to like handling the dispatches for around multiple stores. and developer experience. So if like people, how many of you already know about Redux and have been using Redux? Yeah, so Redux already has a Redux dev tools, as you all know, and it actually brings down the, like it makes a lot easier to debug and then actually see how it's actually working. And the ecosystem, like it has a very like vast ecosystem which has been developing. The Redux community is very strong. And it's very simple to use. Like you don't have any sort of complexity, as I talked about, and easier to understand. You can dispatch actions, and then all happens in a single store, which you can actually visualize in the Redux store via the dev tools as well. So yeah, directory structure and hierarchy. Like I'll be talking about what directory structure are we following in our project, and the hierarchy. Like how is it helping us, and how is it beneficial? So yeah, this is the source folder, like which contains all the main source code of our repository. And inside it, we had created a separate Redux folder. So even if a new developer comes like on day one, and if he wants to know where are actually all the Redux files that has been created, so you can easily identify, yeah, that is Redux, and I have to go inside it. So we have a division sort of like actions, which actually has actions, different sort of actions. It may be related to maybe showing a snack bar, as simple as a snack bar, or maybe making an API call as well. We have action types, which actually defines all the action types that we require for the app to run. And we have the reducers. So these are the reducers. So if I talk about how Redux works, so we have, like, if the app is simple, like if it is based on the state, like Redux state itself, so it's very simple. Like you all manipulate the state of the React component and then use it like normally. But if we use Redux, what happens is from our React components, we actually dispatch actions, Redux actions, which actually manipulate the Redux store, which is maintained globally. So as soon as you call an action, the data, like the attribute regarding which data point you want to change, it changes in the main Redux store, and then it is passed down from top to bottom, as I said, and it is reflected in all the UI components. So this is how it works. So yeah, this is our main root component, like where we pass. So this is the provider, Redux provider, and we pass the store, as I mentioned. So we create a like data structure or a store which is based on our project. What is our need for that? So I'll show you one of them. Yeah. If I see this default state, so this is the Redux state. And this is the authentication part, which we actually require only for managing the authentication part and just the login part of it. So similarly, we have for messages as well, like you interact with SUSI, the response comes. So we handle, like we maintain it throughout the client. And similar for settings and other things as well. Yeah, coming back. So directory structure and hierarchy. So as I say, it is scalable. So as you could see, we have different files for each type of action. So if I want to create a new UI action, you go ahead and just add onto that UI action. But if you want to create a separate type of action entirely, you again go and create a file for that and again insert action into it. So if you go through the code base, it's very easy to actually add and then delete whatever action or reducer you want to. So it's scalable, easy to maintain, and as I said, developer friendly, as you can actually see the Redux file separately integrated into this project, as it was not done together. So as it was added later on, so it is actually taken care of that it actually reflects, like it's added differently, and you can easily see that. And middlewares and helper functions. So for the Redux integration, we have used Redux Promise middleware. As the main reason behind using Redux Promise was, like, we have a very good sense when we use dot then. So we actually know, like, if we dispatch an action and if we use dot then, like, developer, it's very easy to understand, yeah, like, this will happen after the first step executes. So the main reason was that, and also to actually make it asynchronous. That is the main prime reason to make the behavior asynchronous. And yeah, we have made an Ajax helper using Axios. I'll show that.